This is Hatton Hall, an ancient monument from a vanished age. Here in Derbyshire's Peak District, this extraordinary manor house is trapped in time, exactly how it used to be during the reign of Elizabeth I in the year 1590. Today, a remarkable project is about to take place.
Oh, and the dog.
Without the use of modern conveniences, a group of historians and archaeologists will prepare a Tudor feast as it would have been over 400 years ago.
Utterly stunning.
Tudor version of ironing.
They'll wear clothes from the period, source food from the land.
See? Spot on.
And use recipes from the era.
Five udders. Now that's a little more unusual.
They'll be turning the clock back to rediscover a way of life from an age gone by. Standing on a 3,000-acre estate in the Peak District and uninhabited for over three centuries, Hatton Hall has survived wars, changing fashions and family misfortunes. Now a group of experts will breathe new life into the heart of the house. They'll step back in time to recreate a Tudor feast using only the resources available in 1590, the year the house was completed. This was a time of huge social change, when new worlds were discovered and new tastes were emerging.
This was England working out where it is, what it wants to do, what its place in the world's going to be. It has a choice, it's broken away from Rome and from the rest of Europe. It's time to go for it, and it does on every sense. The architecture, the art and the food, the sudden exploration of the world, finding out what's out there and bringing all that produce back. It must have been an exciting time to live.
Mark Meltonville runs the historic Royal Kitchens at Hampton Court, where he regularly cooks using old Tudor recipes.
This is quite a challenge. We've got a tantalising glimpse of what we think we should do. You've got the most ambiguous of recipes to work from. You have a cookery system which works on fires, so how on earth can they tell you how long to put it in the oven for? These ovens are stone, so no one gives you any timings for the ovens, for the roasting, for the boiling. They'll just say, cook until done. So in every recipe we're going to use, there's probably 20 ways of doing it.
With none of today's labour-saving devices, the team will need all their knowledge and skills to cook food from the period using only surviving recipes.
Dress the peacock with all his feathers in such sort that when it is enough, it shall seem to be alive.
Ruth Goodman is an historian specialising in the domestic practices of the period.
We're going to be trying to do both the centrepieces, all the sort of visual, pretty things on the table, and also a variety of dishes and all the sauces and flavours. And we're also going to try and serve it in a Tudor way.
Archaeologists Hugh Beamish, Alex Langlands and Peter Ginn, nicknamed Fonz, will supply much of the labour in the kitchen.
Don't all Tudor feasts have boar's head with an apple stuffed?
Well, we could have. Yeah. Couldn't we?
Could do a boar's head.
Well, I mean, have you had a walk around this place?
Oh, yeah, I've seen on the crest, the boar's head on the crest for the family.
Yeah.
Peacocks and boars.
Yeah, peacocks and boars are everywhere, aren't they?
So we've got a boar and a peacock, definite.
It's got to be posh, expensive, exotic ingredients, time-consuming things. Everything that makes the diners realise that this is the place to eat.
Turning theory into practice, over the next 3 days, our team will cook peacock, wild boar, venison and an array of salads and elaborate sweet dishes as they attempt to recreate an authentic Tudor feast. The team's first task is to bring the kitchen back into full working order for the first time in over three centuries. At Hatton Hall, as many as three wood fires would have been in regular use. Fonz and Hugh are attempting to relight the copper.
The copper is this, so-called because it's a large copper dish that contains water, and it's used for boiling water. So you put your water on the top, you light a fire underneath, you put a lid on top, you let it boil, and hopefully within a short space of time you have hot water. Right, going to have a go with the flint and steel now.
Flint, steel. Strike the two together and you get sparks. Yeah.
A bit like a modern lighter.
Very much like it.
But yeah. Where's the gas?
no gas. However, we have a piece of char cloth, a piece of fine linen cloth that's almost baked, really, really dry.
Right.
So hopefully it will take a spark quite easily from the flint. Happy with the theory?
I'm happy with the theory. It's not as easy as it looks.
No, unfortunately not.
Like most chores in the kitchen, lighting the fires was a slow and painstaking job.
Here we go. Right, so you've got that lit.
Mm-hmm. Just kind of place it inside this bit of tow. Right. It's going, isn't it? Yeah. That's it. Just keep blowing really, really gently.
Working in the kitchens at Haddon Hall was a privileged position. Here, the cooks were almost all male. Men's wages were higher, so affluent households employed them as a status symbol. Women were often given the more menial tasks.
A household this size uses the most enormous amount of water. I mean, all your cooking water, all your washing water, all your drinking water, all your washing up water. It's all got to be collected by bucket and yoke. I mean, the yoke does help because it sort of spreads the weight onto your spine rather than hanging off your arms. And it stops the buckets banging against your legs.
Few houses had the luxury of piped water. The hall had to rely on both its natural resources physical labour.
Much of the women's work at this time is really, really physical. It's not, if you were some fey little thing, it's still delicate, you wouldn't last 5 minutes. You had to be physically strong. If you weren't, you couldn't get work, you'd go hungry. And when people hired servants, they looked at their physique to see that they were tough. They must have been pretty darn tough, actually. When you start doing this work, it's absolutely exhausting. Water. It's pretty heavy stuff.
In the kitchen, Fons and Hugh have brought the copper fire up to heat.
Good heat, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
This is a very exciting moment for us because this is the first time in over 300 years that these fires have been lit. We're looking forward to seeing how they do. So we have to get this under here quite soon, Hugh, won't we?
I think so.
Fantastic.
Oh,
lovely. Good
job
there.
Got water? Uh-huh. Let's stick some in. Right, I suppose wait for that to boil and I can do my jousting.
Not going to take long, is it?
No, not too long.
The kitchen at Haddon Hall was once the engine room of the entire house. Here, a butchery provided a constant supply of expensive meats and game. An adjoining bakehouse produced fresh bread and pies for the table, and highly skilled confectioners made elaborate sweet dishes with exotic ingredients. This was a food production line designed for the sole purpose of large-scale catering. Alex has been kneading dough all morning.
Shall I have a go at kneading that for you?
Oh, yes,
give it a bit of rest.
Please take over.
It's looking good. It's wet enough.
I never need bread making, so knackering.
Oh, it's incredibly good for you. And the upside, of course, is the smell of hot bread. You can smell the yeast in there.
Yeah, I can.
And now the next bit, once we've given this a good stretch and got the gluten moving,
you
want to stick it in a bowl, cloth over the top, put it somewhere warm.
And I put it next to the fire, yeah?
That'll do, that'll be fine. What we could do, though, if we were playing extremely ancient, is stick it outside under an apple tree.
Why not would I do that?
Apples have got natural yeasts on the skin, that's how you make cider. And if you put dough underneath a tree, it rises up quicker.
That's even if you haven't put any yeast in yourself.
But this is not just kind of like an old wives' tale.
No, no, it works.
Backed up by science.
Yeah, but it's also, it would have been old wives by Tudor times. It's very, very ancient.
Right.
You've got brewer's yeast in here. That's going to make it rise up lovely.
Right.
And if we're really lucky, we're going to get a couple of dozen buns out of this. It's getting nice.
How's it feeling?
That's starting to push back now. Feel it. It's less like pastry when you started and becoming more like a dough.
Right.
Starting to spring back. It's rising up itself already.
Yeah.
Go on, Ed. Give that another go and you'll feel it's pushing back.
All right, yeah, I'm with you.
So it's bowl time, and then you just get to make another two.
Another two of these?
That should sound right.
The water in the copper is at boiling point. For the first time in over 300 years, it is ready to be used.
For the feast, I'm going to make some jelly. Now, I'm more used to going to a supermarket and buying jelly in a packet. Whereas for this, I've actually got to extract my own gelatine. Now, gelatine is contained in the skin, in the bone, in the gristle of a pig's trotter. And in order to get it out, I've got to boil them for 8 hours. So I'm just going to pop these in.
Ruth is busy in the still room, a private area of the kitchen where all the work that involved cooking with sugar took place.
Sugar in the 1590s was 16 to 20 times the price of beef. So if you sort of go to the butchers and think how much a pound of good beef is, you know, and sort of scale it up, you sort of find yourself thinking, a modern bag of sugar, that's about 300 quid, you know.
The kitchen staff were rarely trusted with the task of preparing the sweet dishes.
The work in here was actually done by ladies of the house. It might be the wife, it might be the lady of the house, or it might be her sister or other female relatives. If you allowed a servant in here, it would be under close supervision.
Following a surviving recipe from the period, Ruth is attempting to make a marchpane, an iced and gilded marzipan cake that only the very richest households could afford.
How to make a good marchpane. First, take a pound of long, small almonds, blanch them in cold water, and then take a cloth and dry them as dry as you can. And then it says that I have to stamp them small in a mortar. It then goes on to say that having reduced my almonds to ground almond powder, I've got to add in sugar that I've already ground. Oh, God, the labour. I can't tell you how long it's taken me. I've done one batch here, in the bowl. I was about an hour and a half of pounding. I've got about three times that much to go. I'm on the second lot. My arms are killing me. So I think, to be honest, I might call in some labour from the boys. Help!
Alex?
Yeah?
Come give me a hand, could you?
Yeah, just a second. What can I help you with?
Oh, I couldn't just do that pounding some sugar for me, could you?
Just pounding this, yeah? OK, so just going to grind it right down, yeah?
Yeah, I'll start the almonds.
Into a powder.
Yeah, like this one, look. That's...
Oh, it's like flour.
Yeah, that's the point.
It's going to take me ages, Ruth.
Yes.
A lot of manpower, these sweets. Should I say woman power?
Yeah, they are, aren't they? It's oh, God, going to be here forever.
Hosting large feasts was a regular occurrence in the great households of Tudor England. At Haddon Hall, over 70 servants lived and worked on the estate. Most were employed to provide the kitchen with a constant supply of fresh produce and meat. Released from his kitchen duties, Alex has joined Fons to track down one of the centerpieces for the feast. They've met up with Anthony Salt, who's reintroduced wild boar to his Derbyshire farm.
OK, Anthony, it's taken us a while, but we've tracked them down. What are they doing up there? Are they feeding?
I think they're feeding in that little bit of a glade up there.
Right. But we're at a safe enough distance here now, aren't
we? I think we are at a safe enough distance, yes. They do have a very keen sense of smell.
Right.
But their eyesight isn't too great.
Right.
But obviously we're downwind, so they've not smelt us yet. Otherwise they'd be on the run.
Right.
The hunting of wild boar was a favourite pastime of the landed gentry. Their razor-sharp tusks and powerful jaws made them a formidable prey.
Are they a dangerous animal?
Yes, they can be very ferocious when cornered. I mean, you've got to remember, they're not like a domestic pig.
Right.
They're a wild animal.
Right.
By the 16th century, the indigenous species of wild boar in England had all but died out. Like today, wild boar herds had to be imported from the continent.
I think basically it was down to the amount of damage that they did on the land,
right,
to crops and fields. You know, they can do a tremendous amount of damage in one evening. Landowners really persecuted them and forced them to extinction.
Of course, you've got the depletion of their natural habitat as well, the forests being used for charcoal burning and, of course, for shipbuilding as well in the navy of the 16th century.
That's right, there'd be less and less places for them to sort of hide out in.
So what does boar meat taste like?
It's got its own distinct gamey flavour. It's a lot stronger than commercial pork, and it's very similar texture to beef, really.
Right.
And it's also a lot redder, darker meat than the supermarket pork.
Today, wild boar meat is back in fashion. Anthony has agreed to part with one of his stock boars for the feast at Haddon Hall.
I've ground all the sugar down and all the almonds, and I've beaten the two together with just a little tiny spot of rose water, like it told me to in the book, and I now have marchpane. Perhaps you might know it as marzipan, all that work. Anyway, you can see I've got great big lumps of it, and now I've got to start moulding it into the shape. So, clear myself a space. What I plan to do is a sort of a big circle flat cake, sort of about that deep, I hope, if I've got enough marzipan. And then I'm going to ice it and hopefully gild it. And there's going to have a little tree come out the centre. And this is something I've seen described in period recipes. Let's see how I get on. So I'm just sort of, I think I'm just going to start by putting on a, and seeing that I've got the thickness and how big I'm going to be able to make it.
Pig's trotters have been boiling in the copper for the last 8 hours, and Fons and Mark are now able to start the arduous process of making their jellies.
The moment is a bit like soup. We want it clear, so we're going to have to sieve over and over again to get more and more particles out of the water. And then hopefully we'll be left with a very gelatine-rich water, which, when left to cool, should set hard like a jelly.
I'm going to make an icing out of sugar and egg white, which I've sort of just beaten up a bit together. I'm going to mix them up into something fairly wet, and then I'm going to paint it on with a feather.
While Ruth continues the delicate task of icing the marchpane, in the kitchen's game larder, Alex is skinning a deer in preparation for the feast. He's being helped by local butcher Michael Shirt.
So what we're doing here is the legging then, Michael?
That's correct, yes. What you have to do is leg the animal and then hang it up by its haunches so you can remove the skin in one clean piece, because apart from the meat, which is a valuable part of the carcass, they also used to cure the skin and make a deer skin rug out of it.
Right, so no part of the deer would be wasted then?
Not at all.
Apart from the hooves, maybe?
No, they'd even probably boil them up and make glue out of them.
Right.
In the 16th century, few meats were as prized as venison.
If you were invited to the Lord's manor, and the Lord was serving up venison at the table, he's trying to tell you that he's powerful. You know, he's rich, he's wealthy, he's high up the social order. And of course, he can hunt as well, which is a privilege that was only extended to the very, very upper classes.
Right, and you want to twist it round.
Twist it round, yeah.
Lovely.
Right, so, off you go.
A minute.
We've already taken out the insides, haven't we?
That's right. Put the poor garlic in, by the way, which you take the intestines, and you also take this out, which is the pluck.
Right.
We've got the windpipe here, and then the lungs,
right,
the heart, and the liver.
You see, these are the umbles, are they, or the humbles?
That's correct, yes, which they used to give to the
the peasants, the people lower down the scale.
So people lower down the social order would get to eat the humbles, and that's where the phrase to eat humble pie comes
from. Correct, yes.
To be humble.
Now we've legged it, this is the next process. We're just going to pull the skin straight down here, quite swiftly, and leave the carcass behind, and hopefully have a nice clean skin.
Okay.
So I'd like to get hold of that, Alex, there.
Get hold of that?
And yeah, and pull it down. That's lovely. Lovely. There we are. Lovely carcass of venison there. That's basically it.
Just need to debone it now and it's ready for the spit.
That's right.
In the main kitchen, Fons and Mark are still straining the gelatine.
Even making jelly is hard work, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's the whole point, because not all the food's expensive because of where it's come from. Some of it's expensive because of the labour involved. So it might only be pigstroppers, four man's food, but two people, that's you and me, have got to do this for hours just so they can get a plate of jelly.
Hence why we're doing it for a feast, not a kid's party.
Yeah.
In its day, Haddon Hall was one of the grandest houses in the country, reflecting both the wealth and extravagance of the Tudor upper classes. To understand more about its culinary past, Ruth has met up with local historian Mary Lloyd in the hall's magnificent long gallery.
Oh, isn't that? That's the Boar's Head, isn't it? Isn't that the Manners family?
Well, it is the Boar, but it's the Vernon family who built the house.
Oh, right.
There's our peacock up there.
Oh, isn't that lovely? I'd never have been allowed in here, would I? I mean, you know, 400 years ago, I wouldn't be allowed anywhere near the place.
Sir John Manners and his family were living at Haddon Hall in 1590. The family still own the house today.
Oh, wow. We have some of the original orders for food.
So these are food lists. From here?
Yes.
Of about the date we're doing?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, look, let's see. Sir John Manners. Oh, well, that pretty much dates it, doesn't it?
It does, yeah.
3 dozen chicken, 11 dozen pigeons.
Oh, there's loads of stuff.
3 barrels of oysters.
3 barrels of oysters.
Well, I suppose they were cheap in those days,
well,
weren't
they? Were.
5 udders. Now, that's a little more unusual.
Yes.
Just by the sheer quantities, you know, they've got to be some special event, aren't they?
John Manners' father-in-law, Sir George Vernon, he was quite a one for throwing feasts because he was known as the King of the Peak.
He was
known
for
his hospitality. Yeah. So he was probably known for giving banquets left, right and
centre. Yeah.
The great feasts at Haddon Hall were famous. A portrait from the period depicts the Christmas revelries in the Great Hall. According to legend, it was during a feast that Dorothy Vernon, younger daughter of Sir George, eloped to marry John Manners. Their children became the Dukes of Rutland.
There's this sort of tradition in this house of large-scale entertaining.
Mm.
Oh, fantastic.
It's the end of the working day for the team. Time to take some well-earned rest. And for the workers at Haddon Hall, it's a chance to eat a dinner of humble pie.
Just the humble pie.
Humble pie.
Humble pie. Yeah,
go on, who's going to be brave and cut it open? Go on, Alex, go on.
Pause.
So you take the top off and we get a stunningly good pie. Good rosemary flavour.
Mm.
That's nice, that is. I like
that's
that.
Very nice.
The team are settling into their new roles, but they still have a lot of work ahead of them.
You know, we've got to the end of the day and everything we plan to do
is done.
Yeah.
How's your milk, how's your jelly coming on anyway?
Good.
Yeah, good.
You seem confident, he didn't seem so confident.
I'm eternally confident.
A new day at Haddon Hall, and the team must start by gathering together more ingredients for the feast. Kitchen staff relied on the estate itself for all the fresh produce they needed. Ruth is raiding the hall's herb garden.
The herb garden would have been absolutely central to a great estate. It's not only for food, and of course that's very important, to have fun and interesting food. You also need your herb garden for things like the insecticides that keep your house clean of pests, things that keep smell at bay, for cleaning agents. It's a pretty huge list, and without it, it's quite hard to see how a Tudor household would function.
An enormous variety of different herbs and plants were used in a Tudor kitchen. Much of their food was preserved with salt, so powerful flavourings were needed to disguise the taste. But herbs also had other valuable properties.
Of course, these plants were eaten not just for their flavour, although that's important, but also for their medicinal properties. The theory of how the body worked in the period said that everything had to be in balance and that there was four basic humours, blood, phlegm, yellow bile and black bile, and you had to have this perfect balance. That's what health was. But each of us individually all had a different balance, so men are different from women and young are different from old, and people with different colouring are different from each other. So I'm ginger, that means I have a lot of the yellow bile, the hot, dry collar. I'm choleric by nature and therefore hot-tempered. I would need to make sure that I didn't eat too many hot, dry foods. So not much mustard or pepper or horseradish, but lots and lots of cool food. So I should be eating the angelica along with lettuce and celery and things like that, which were considered to be cooling and calming and would make me a nicer person all round.
To cook the large number of dishes they're planning for the feast, the team will use a huge amount of fuel. They need to restock their wood stores.
Can you think of all the many fires they've got over at Haddon Hall? Back in the 16th century, they would have used an enormous amount of wood. I think you've got fires for cooking, fires for heating, fires for keep boiling water as well. I mean, you've basically got fires running pretty much every day of the year.
On the other side of the estate, Fons has come down to the river with local angler Richard Ward to try his luck at a spot of fishing.
You really must stay hidden.
They're using a rod and line similar to that used by anglers in the 16th century.
This is pretty typical of a slightly upmarket rod that the Tudors would have used. They've been around for at least 100 years, and the butt section that I'm using here is made of hazel.
Yeah.
And it has a slice taken out of it up here at the top.
Sort of angular cuts.
And then
yeah.
I've got a section here of blackthorn, which is very springy, resilient wood, which you fasten together. And I've got linen thread, which is waxed with beeswax, and that holds it very tightly. There's no glue in there. It can move about, expand or mushroom, whatever. Yeah. First of all, there's a very heavy horsehair fishing line here. This is 21 hairs. That's three bunches of seven twisted to make a little rope. And then there's another piece, and it's knotted together with a knot that's still used today by anglers. It's called a water knot. But they knew what they were doing. I mean, these guys, because, you know, it was important that they succeeded, because it was part of going shopping. It was going to get some grub. You know, they didn't go to the shops. They had to get that for themselves.
The River Wye, running through Haddon Hall's estate, not only supplied the kitchen with fresh water, but also a constant supply of fresh brown trout.
The brown trout's natural environment has been slowly eroded by man's use of the waterways.
Yes.
So we're very lucky here at Haddon Hall to actually have a river that runs past that has got brown trout in it. But I'm not so sure if we're going to be so lucky to catch ourselves one.
We will, but probably not here. I think we've scared away the fish that were just here. They'll not have gone far, but they just won't eat. I mean, you wouldn't eat if you were frightened, would you? If somebody was threatening some nasty Spaniard with a sword was at your throat, you'd not be ready to eat a pork pie, would you?
But I'm always ready to eat a pork pie.
So I have to bring it.
That's the problem. They're all over there by that bank.
Yeah. Anglers through the ages have learnt to their cost they must not let the fish see them. Well, shall we go and try another bit of river?
Yes.
Where we've not frightened all the fish. We'll try not to frighten them at the next spot.
Sure.
These are strawberries, wild strawberries, and these are the only sort of strawberries that Tudors had. That the modern great big fat things, they're a hybrid between these and something that's found in America. But whenever you see strawberries, just these little tiny little things, they're really lovely though, they're so sweet. I've seen accounts of gentlemen in London, and they've kept sort of household accounts, and it says for their dinner that they had a pint of strawberries and a chicken, which would be pretty damn gorgeous, wouldn't you? I mean, think how many you'd need, it'd be hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them, wouldn't it?
Thank you.
just have a go with this, you'll find it smashing.
Okay.
Just hold it there.
Just hold there.
Yeah. And the trick is not to put lots of power on the forward cast. It's just, if anything, if it's you do put any power on, it's a little bit back on the back cast, and then just ease it forward. Okay. And forward. Bang it back a bit. That's it. And there you are. That's it. Spot on.
Just need a fish now.
Yes.
Just need a bite.
Let it. Aye. Charles Cotton, who ancient Derbyshire angler, used to say that any man who couldn't land a 16-inch trout on two hairs was not fit to call himself an angler. So I'm unfit, I'm afraid. I just find this stuff so amazingly frail.
For a feast like ours, we would have used a brown trout.
They'd have all been brown trout, and you'd have used all methods to catch them. You'd have had traps in the river. There'd have been people up at dawn with bread and worms. You know, if it was an important feast, you know, nobility or royalty visiting,
they would
go and get it, and there wouldn't be. There's no sporting aspect to it at all. It would have been get them caught.
We don't seem to be doing very well, do we?
No, let's hope that all the rest of the estate workers have caught plenty of trout, because we're not doing very well at all.
We'll have to get the traps out.
Yes.
As Alex returns to the hall with a new supply of faggots and kindling, in the kitchen, the rest of the team are getting ready for an afternoon of baking. Ruth is attempting to fire the kitchen's 400-year-old bread ovens.
The oven itself is just a sort of stone cave, or maybe a brick cave. It has to be a very specific shape to make this fire move in the right way so that it heats evenly. And then it's the hot stones of the cave that do the cooking for you. So at the moment we've just got a little fire happening in the middle, and the flames are going straight up. That's a baby fire, just started. As the fire develops, we're looking to move the flame around the shape. And what we'll end up in a bit, it's starting to get a plume, so it'll go up straight and it'll hit the roof, spread, and start to come down the side, heating the side like a mushroom cloud sort of thing. And then later, it's going to come in sort of at the base and then curl the way round and back up. So what I'm aiming at is a very particular shape and colour and form of flame to tell me that the oven is heating properly. It's pretty accurate. But like so many things, it requires skill, a bit more skill than just turning a knob. Anyway, more wood. For an oven that hasn't been in regular use, this is working superbly well. I wonder who the last person who used this was. Somebody was probably only too glad to see the back of it, I should imagine. Huge amount of work.
The ovens are proving to be more successful than Richard and Fonz, who have yet to catch a single trout.
And to all fish.
Colour of the day?
If you like, yeah. We won't get into serious trouble.
It's wet.
We're the Lord's favourites, aren't we? Now, look, we mustn't waste that.
What's that?
This is sheep. And it's where they've rubbed it off, and in fact, it looks like a bit of lamb's wool. But we just mustn't waste that. That makes good dubbing. That's for the bodies of the fly.
And we'll keep that
in our dubbing bag, ready for we want to tie some more flies.
Time, yeah.
Pick anything up like that. Anything that's fur. If you find black sheep's wool, even a mouse, the fur can be used for making flies' bodies with.
Oh, I'll keep my eyes peeled.
Yes.
I wish they'd invented tea in Tudor times.
Hey, that fish is still rising here.
With the ovens warming, Ruth is finally ready to start preparing the centrepiece for the Lord's table. The Tudor upper classes loved to dazzle their guests with great visual displays, and few dishes were more spectacular than the peacock pie.
Doesn't it look lovely?
Gorgeous,
absolutely beautiful.
Look, he hasn't even started dragging his tail feathers, so look, they're perfect.
Yep.
Right up to the end.
Not even a scuff on them.
Gorgeous.
He looks, yeah, he is extremely fresh.
Right, so is it me skinning this?
Yes.
In Tudor England, people's poultry yards contained a huge variety of poultry. Not just chickens, but also ducks and geese and peacocks and swans were all sort of farmed, in essence, for the table. We don't really seem to do that anymore. I'm not really quite sure why. I can't think of why we don't. I mean, peacock's a perfectly nice bird to eat. But for some reason, people think they should only be looked at these days.
I suppose you have to think it's just a pretty chicken, though, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
People get it, you know, it's a bit, oh, poor little thing. Well, you know, chickens are pretty, too.
I'm trying to take the skin off in one complete piece so that we can then reuse the skin, because the skin is going to go to table two. It's going to be part of a big visual display. And obviously we're going to eat the bird himself, which hopefully should be very nice. I must say, in the books, all the books I've ever read, I've tried to claim that peacock is disgusting, and yet the two times I've done it before, actually, I thought it was lovely.
The diet of the landed gentry differed greatly from that of the lower classes. Poultry of any kind was considered a luxury. Even chicken was seldom eaten.
The lower classes very rarely ate poultry. Chicken was an expensive meat simply because it's so much more valuable alive as an egg layer. Chicken only became a cheap meat from the last quarter of the 20th century when we introduced battery farming. Before that, all poultry was expensive meat.
While Ruth continues the delicate art of skinning the peacock, Mark has been given the task of making a spice mix for the pie, ingredients that were only available in the wealthiest households.
The whole point of these spices that go into this pie are money. Everything we're doing about this meal is to show off. You're in a big house, you've got fantastic room, fantastic equipment, fantastic food. It's got to cost, cost, cost. Things that other people can't have. They've come from all over the world. It's always difficult to tell, you know, people say, how much is that worth? And you give a few pence and it doesn't sound anything because we don't use the same money as them. But cinnamon's a good indication. That's just a cinnamon stick. We all buy it at Christmas, sometimes put a bit on a bit of custard, think nothing of it, leave it in the back of the cupboard. Nearly 500 years ago, if I could afford to buy three ships, put a crew on board, send it all the way down to the Spice Islands, fill them up with cinnamon, if one of those ships makes it back 3 years later, we've made enough profit to pay for everything, to pay for the losses, to keep ourselves in good living for many years. So it's worth a fortune.
I'm nearly done here, and it's gone quite well, actually. He was warm, and that makes a lot of difference. Trying to skin something with so much plumage and in such condition is a bit of a challenge, it must be said. So, you know, you can't spoil something as gorgeous as this, can you? Right, last little bit here. Meat. And peacock. Cool. Look at that. That's going to look amazing on table, isn't it? Absolutely fantastic. I'm really pleased with that.
With the skinning of the peacock complete, the rest of the team can now prepare the filling for the pie.
I'm just chopping up the beef suet, and this is going in our peacock pie. And Ruth said I've got to dice this up really small. We're going to mix it in with all the meat and the dried fruits as well, just to keep our pie nice and moist, nice and succulent.
Tiny bit of something now that none of us think about, the nutmeg. Nutmeg was the new spice for the late Tudors. We're told entire estates were lost over the trade in nutmegs when the bottom fell out of the nutmeg market not much later. Someone else who has the purse strings to this house is going to give me meagre amounts of each one and said, there you are, that's enough for your peacock pie, because otherwise I'm going to pick up this nutmeg and I'm going to be off down the drive and live like a king forever. So you need to take these away from me quite quickly.
Oh, that's nice. We have got enough, have we?
Yeah.
Want them really, really, really full and solid.
Yeah, there won't be any gaps in this.
Yeah. A momentary respite for the team while the bread ovens are still heating allows Ruth to begin applying the finishing touches to her marge pane. She's gilding its edges with gold leaf.
This is real gold, and therefore costs a blinking fortune, and always did. And that's the point. It's real conspicuous consumption. You can't do this with fake gold, because fake gold would make you ill if you ate it. Whereas real gold is inert, goes in one end, straight through, out the other end, and does no harm on the way. So you can eat real gold. But gold has always been the price of gold. And I suppose whoever was doing it at any date in history must have felt the pressure. But perhaps they had a bit more practice, I don't know. In the period, they actually just took a small lump of gold and some poor bloke just hit it with hammers on a cushion until they got it down to this really, really, really fine sheet. I mean, the skill involved in beating something so that you don't break it and go through it, that just beggars belief. I'm having trouble picking it up without breaking it, you know. But I think my real worry is that we won't get the finish. You know, the final quality of presentation that they would have had in the period. I have a feeling that we might end up with something that's a little bit rustic.
As Ruth contemplates the team's progress, a critical moment has arrived in the bakehouse.
Breaking out the hot coals, because the ovens are now up to temperature. The stone is hot enough to cook the bread.
With the ovens up to temperature, the team have just seconds to get all the bread and pies in before the stones begin to cool.
And the dough.
That first moment when you take the fire out and you get the bread in has to happen really, really fast, because obviously once you've taken the fire out and the doors are open, your oven is beginning to cool down.
The bread and pies will bake in the ovens overnight. A simple dough mixture is used to seal the doors and prevent the heat from escaping.
Now we can relax. Now we can take our time, get rid of the ashes, and then seal up the doors, and then we can all go and do something else much quieter and calmer.
The day of the feast has arrived, and our team are up at dawn preparing for a long day of cooking ahead.
So the first job in the morning is to get this fire lit. 5 o'clock, servants, people like Fons and myself, are up, getting together our tinder and some nice little bits of kindling, get this thing lit so that we can get it up to heat as soon as possible, because we've got so much to cook today and we're going to cook in so many different ways. So someone's always going to be on hand on this fire, tending it, making sure it's up to heat.
Ruth's first task of the morning is to apply the finishing touches to her peacock pie.
Is the peacock pie out of the oven? Baked quite nicely, isn't it? Right, all I've got to do now is get the skin on top of it. Right.
Ruth's recipe for the dish describes how the pie should be covered with the skin of the peacock using a wire frame, as if the bird was still alive on the table.
More than great. That's utterly stunning.
Along with the centerpieces, the team are also cooking a huge array of different meats, salads and sweets. In a wealthy household, both quality and quantity lay at the heart of a successful feast.
We've got gammons to go in, we even talked about some chickens at the last minute, we've got venison to spit roast, we've got wild boar to spit roast, we've got the peacock pie to sort out, we've got more bread rolls to do, we've got all the sweets to do, we've got toast to do. I mean, toast for 40 people is the last thing I need.
We're producing so much food. When you look at this and you see it all, you think, well, you can't eat all that, and that's the whole point. You're not supposed to be able to eat it all. What you're doing is giving your guests a choice. Even today, a lot of people don't choose what they eat, they just don't get very much. And it was certainly that case in Tudor England. Most people ate very little and didn't get any choice at all. So when you sit down at this meal, just everything out in front of you. What do you want? You know, tantalise your taste buds. Do you fancy the chicken, the venison, the salads, the artichokes, the pies? Or do you just want gammon? Nobody minds what you eat, but you've been given choice. It's like having a written menu live in front of you on the table.
As most of the dishes have to be cooked from fresh, the scale of the task is beginning to dawn on Fons.
I don't think I've ever cooked so many different dishes at one time for so many people. So there's a bit of trepidation, wondering whether it's all going to come together, all going to be right for the feast.
This, what started off as a really simple salad, came one of those ideas. This came out of that first idea. What was their crest like? We're talking about, let's put a boar on the table, let's put a peacock on the table. And then there was, let's make a salad like the crest. Well, that's easily said. It's going to taste like an egg salad. Is that what it is?
We're going to spit roast our venison and our boar. So we're going to bank up the fire behind, and that will grill the meat. But also, we've got a fry on it, we've also got a boil on it, so we can alter the shape of our fire to our cooking needs.
To spit roast all the meats in time for the feast, Alex and Fons must get the main fire up to temperature as soon as possible.
It's looking good, isn't it?
Well, it's there, but we're just going to, you know, load it up with wood now.
That's it. Just fill that place with fire.
Yeah.
Loads of vegetables to blanch, cabbages to blanch, ready for the salads.
And we've got the meat. We've got to get the meat on the spit, yep.
Yep. That's got to be done within the hour.
Or big wood thing. One of the big things I've learned so far from this experience is the amount of preparation work that goes into every dish. Like today, ingredients are all about these sort of kind of things being thrown together in the kitchen. And I think because we've got food blenders, things that can just cut out all the hard work, we kind of take it for granted. Because in the Tudor period, dicing things really fine and having everything processed over such a long period by so many people, that's where the status is. So that's one thing that's really kind of dawned on me.
This was a dynamic time for England. The merchant classes in the towns were flourishing. The old aristocracy found themselves under increasing pressure from families with newfound wealth. At Haddon Hall, the level of detail that went into every aspect of a feast was part of a deliberate attempt to send specific messages to its guests.
So this is the top table. The two side tables are laid quite simply, but this one we're going to invest some time on. It's all part of this imagery of the Great Hall. Everyone dining here literally knows their place. The ones sat at the far ends are going to realise how far, not just in space, but in money, they are from the man sat in the middle, sat behind this fantastic tapestry. On a table that isn't on the same level as everyone else, his table's lifted up on stones on something called the dais. So he's elevated already just by sitting higher than you, looking down on the rest of you. He's got the best light. He's got a thing called an oriel window to the one side, so the light cascades down on his table. The rest of you make do with what you can. And this table's going to get three tablecloths. Tudor version of ironing. Down straight down the middle with the seam.
The Lord's table would be adorned with as much fine linen as possible.
This was the easy one.
Quality napery was highly desired by the Tudor gentry.
Lovely. Nice seam down the front. It's cloth, cloth, cloth. You're in a time when cloth is money. And the nicer cloth you have, the more money you must have, and the amount of cloth you have must show how much money you have. So it might just look like a white tablecloth as we walk into the room, but to your Tudor, you've got a really flash car here.
With the presentation of food as important as its taste, the staff in the kitchen face a daunting challenge if they're to reach the high standards of upmarket Elizabethan cuisine.
Not long now. What are we looking at? A couple of hours, is it?
Couple of hours. At the moment, I'm just trying to knock up it's a tricula salad with salmon, mushy peas, and onions. But even that is requiring so much work. I've had to dice the carrots. Alex is doing me some onions. I'm currently up to my elbows in peas. And, oh dear.
Every time I see you, you seem to have your hands in, sort of all
something gooey.
Before anything can be sent to table, each individual dish has to be carefully arranged.
I'm just starting to dress Boar's head for the table. We lost a little bit of the skin off his nose when he came out of the cauldron. So I think I've got a bit of gelatine still. Might just sort of paint it over with gelatine and then stick something there to hide it.
Over at the main fire, the venison and boar meat has been roasting for the last 2 hours.
Slightly burnt on the side of it. Well, it's a little bit charred, isn't it? Is that it? I think it's Fonz's fault.
Nowadays, we'd stick this napkin on our lap to catch any food we dropped, but that's not going to happen tonight, because my diners know how to eat Tudor style, so they're going to put it up here on their left-hand shoulder. It looks a bit odd at first until you think about eating with your hands. It's perfect, just there for wiping and keeping the mouth clean.
The term etiquette had yet to be invented. The Tudor equivalent was courtesy, a belief that a well-mannered lady or gentleman should behave in a way that demonstrated their superior upbringing.
Anyone able to eat in a great hall like this will have grown up with good manners. And luckily for us, the manners books still survive to teach us what those good manners were. Sat here at the high table, before the meal even starts, I'm going to have my hands washed. Servants are going to bring me a bowl of warm water, maybe some soap, and I'll put my hands out and have my hands actually washed for me, part of status. Anything that can't be eaten with a spoon, and I've got a gorgeous gold one here for his lordship, you're going to need your knife, because you're supposed to cut it up into what they called fair gobbets. It's a lovely word. It just means mouse-sized pieces. So a piece of lovely roasted meat is picked up with the fingers and the knife, put onto this tiny little plate, the trencher, and cut up into pieces so that you can then put your knife down, clean everything with your napkin. So if we get our meal just how it should be tonight, it should be the height of good manners.
Not all Tudor dishes took hours to produce. With the feast fast approaching, the team are creating syllabub, a simple dessert containing spiced wine and cream. To mix the two ingredients together, Alex has found the highest point in the kitchen to pour the cream into bowls of wine below.
This sort of wine curdles cream a little bit. It's sort of semi-set, so you get sort of like flavoured, creamy wine with a sort of bubbly texture. It's dead nice. 2, 3, go! Yep.
Oh. There's still loads of cream in here.
It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and guests are arriving for the feast. The Tudors ate early by modern standards, making best use of the available daylight. The team need to be ready to serve in only an hour's time. They're busy taking the finished dishes to the pantry to be organised and arranged.
We've got a few things that aren't finished to quite the degree we would have liked, but not bad, not bad. Perhaps if we got together more often, you know, got to practice together, maybe we'd get slicker.
2 leech. Oh, a long reach for a leech. And back and through and tie.
So far, so good. Pretty much everything has gone to plan.
Yeah,
the only thing we've had a problem with the spit roast.
Hang on.
It could have done with a couple more hours. Maybe another hour. And we've just run out of time now, and we've just got to throw everything in what we've got. But to be honest, we've just got so many chickens and gammons, we're not going to miss it. But the venison worked fine, so that was good news.
Salad.
We've got a roast pork, we've got roast venison, we've got salads of artichokes, we've got gammon. Lots of gammon, March pain. I've got some cheese made into small balls, and I've got fried black pudding with fried chicken. Is there another plant of gammon out there?
Another gammon, we've got this one here.
No, there should be a chopped gammon.
After 3 days of hard graft, the team are finally ready to start serving the food. But before any dishes are sent to the great hall, the men must change into their livery uniforms.
throw that over your right shoulder, and like that. Yeah, hand on belly, something like that. Yeah.
We might just have to stand around doing nothing for a while. Okay, well, right. should we get dishing up then?
Yeah. Female servants weren't permitted to serve food to guests. Male staff, on the other hand, were expected to be well presented.
I'm just trying to get everything together here in the pantry so that it goes out in order and all together. And it goes bonk, 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 bonk on the table. Evenly, correctly spaced. So I need to get my numbers right. So I'm trying to do things in threes or sixes. I've got a couple of twos, which I'm going to have to divide. And the singles are basically centrepieces.
As the centrepiece for the Lord's table, Ruth's peacock pie is the first dish served. To add to the spectacle, the original recipe suggests the bird should be spitting fire from its beak. The host's table is the first to be filled with the expensive, labour-intensive dishes.
As such, didn't really exist at this point. You have removes. So you fill the table with food, and then when everybody's finished eating it, you remove it, and that's one remove. And then you fill the tables again, and usually it's no more than two removes. It's very unusual to go for three.
The side tables are the next to be served. They're given a cheaper, more basic selection. Once the tables are filled with as much food as they can hold, the feast can finally begin. It has taken our team 3 long days to prepare all the food and dishes in the style of the period. Now, all their hard work in the kitchen is disappearing in front of them. For Ruth, it is a brief yet satisfying glimpse into a distant past.
I don't think we've done too bad, really. I think it's something quite like I imagined a Tudor feast to be. It's pretty gutsy stuff, with this real powerful understanding and use of good meat and good vegetables. I don't think there was a lot of prudery in the 1590s. I think people were fairly living life to the full. You know, it might go like that. Life is short, you make the most of it.
As the final dish, Ruth's iced and gilded marchpane is presented at the Lord's table. For our team, employment at Haddon Hall has come to an end. As the revelries continue long into the evening, for the first time in over 4 centuries, this great hall is once again alive to the sights and sounds of a Tudor feast.
Exploring how King Henry VIII was a lover of art, but was he a patron or a plunderer next on BBC Two? Then Natalie Portman plays Anne and Scarlett Johansson is the other Boleyn girl in the movie drama at 9:35.